Hi, I'm LadyJenevia. Today's video is going to be a review of a new Netflix series called First Kill. I wanted to make this video and publish it a while ago, but the press embargo wasn't until midnight of the show's premiere day, which in and of itself could potentially feel like a bit of a red flag. Usually I don't have press embargoes for reviews on the same day of the premiere unless it's a non-US project, for example, Jean-Pierre Jeunet's Big Bug or Jonas Åkerlund's Clark series, but that's neither here nor there. Being that I will be able to post this when the show is already available to the masses, I am going to be talking about spoilers in this video. There's just not a lot of point in refusing to do so altogether, but I will at least start the video with minimal spoilers, and then I will let you know when I'm going to start going into more detail. To start things off, the basic premise of the series is we have Juliet Fairmont, who comes from a family of legacy vampires, which more or less means that they're very powerful, they can walk out in the sunlight during the day when other vampires who are not legacy cannot. And looking at the size of the mansion Juliet lives in with her family, I would basically liken them to vampire aristocracy. It's a whole lot of generational wealth that puts you in a house like that. Either that or guiltlessly milking the exploitation of workers for your own profits. The other main character of the series, Calliope Burns, also known as Cal, comes from a family of hunters. Not only of vampires, but other supernatural creatures, monsters, things that go bump in the night. If you've seen the trailer for the show, then you know that a romantic relationship develops between Juliet and Cal. But given the fact that the groups they're a part of, vampires and hunters, respectively, are mortal enemies, this proves to be difficult. I was really looking forward to watching this series. I went into the viewing experience expecting to mostly be positive in my feedback because I really liked the concept. I love Twilight, I love Romeo and Juliet, and this was giving those vibes, albeit for sapphics, and we love that. Happy Pride. Therefore, I take no pleasure in saying that I actually had multiple issues with this series. I wanted to love it, and there were things about it that I liked, but the issues I had with the execution of the material and the filmmaking on a technical level proved to be a considerable distraction. I will list a few things and do it in a vague way, and then I will circle back around through with a more spoiler-filled explanation of my points. The visual effects I saw were very bad, distractingly bad. It was bad enough to take me out of the moment when I'm trying to stay in there with the dramatic and emotional stakes of the story. There were some very questionable editing choices, and I'm by no means an expert at editing, but it was really, really bad to the point that even I was having issues watching it, and the more I would notice the problems with things like visual effects and editing, the more tuned in I was to notice any time they would have further problems in those specific areas. Not all of my feedback is negative, though. I liked whenever they would lean deeper into the allegory of being supernatural, leading to having to potentially deal with bigotry-fueled violence. The problem is, though, when you have technical problems like the ones I previously mentioned, it would distract me from immersing myself as deeply into that socio-political commentary as I would have liked, and, like I said, the dramatic stakes of the story. I think that there is still the possibility that the show's main target audience will still enjoy the show to a great degree. It's a teen supernatural series, so younger audiences in their tweens and early teens might be less picky about these things than I am. And the other thing about it is that, unfortunately, when you are part of an underrepresented identity group in entertainment media, you don't have as many options to choose from, so there probably aren't as many comparable projects where you have an interracial sapphic couple as the main couple of a supernatural series like this. And I'm speaking from experience about that. When Crazy Rich Asians first came out in cinemas, I got caught up in the hype as an Asian who loves a good rom-com. But now it's been a few years, and the more time passes, the more I dislike that film for reasons I will not elaborate on today, because it's not the topic of this video and I have too much to say about that to do it in a way that is short. In general, I feel like there are a lot of good ideas in the premise of First Kill, but oftentimes I don't think the series lives up to that potential as much as I wanted it to. I didn't hate the show, but I really wanted the world, the sun, and the moon for this series. It leaves a number of storylines open and unresolved, so it absolutely needs a renewal in order to offer the audience any sense of closure or resolution, but I don't know whether or not it will be able to hit the numbers that it will need in order to get that renewal. And that's really sad to know, because I've seen how excited so many queer sapphic viewers have been online about this series and its impending premiere. You're going to have to write a whole lot of fanfiction to try to clean up the mess that happens at the end of this season if the show doesn't end up getting renewed. I do, however, hope that it gets renewed, even if it's just for one more season, because I think viewers, especially young, impressionable viewers, deserve a better wrap-up to the storylines on the show than how this first season ended. Also, for the sake of disclosure, I'm not familiar with the short story that the series is apparently based on, so that is not factoring in at all to my feedback or analysis of the material in the series. If you're feeling underrepresented and that factors into you being excited to watch the series based on the trailer, I would still tell you to watch it, because there just isn't enough to choose from currently, and you still might find plenty of things to enjoy about the series, particularly with the main couple, but I struggle to imagine that the show will be able to captivate more of an audience outside of its core target demographics. So now is when I'm going to talk about the show with more spoilers, so you can choose to keep watching or click off, whatever you prefer. To give you an example of how bad the special effects look, anytime there is blood splatter, it's VFX and it looks really bad. It looks unfinished. And the thing is, sometimes when you are a journalist, a reviewer, a critic, whatever you would like to call it, you might be given access to press screeners for something. And within those screeners, you might see things that are quite literally unfinished. I've seen visible green and blue screens in screeners. I've seen half-finished VFX. The list goes on and on. However, when you are watching unfinished screeners, they will add a disclaimer before the content starts playing in order to inform the person watching the screener that what you are watching might not be finished, so you need to adjust your expectations and judgments accordingly, which I'm perfectly fine with doing when that's the case. However, Netflix has never done that for me. When I get screeners of Netflix projects, they've always been in their final form, so I have to presume that the same can be said for the first kill screeners I was given. Another example of the poor, not only special effects, but the editing, is the attack on the Fairmont house. When those hunters show up and start attacking all the vampires present, the editing is bafflingly choppy, and whenever there's blood splatter, again, the special effects look terrible. I don't understand how this many things can go wrong in a series. I have to believe it's a failure on the part of the leadership of the project. Maybe producers did not do their job when it came to either hiring people who were capable of doing a good job, or budgeting and planning things accordingly so there would be enough funding and hours for these aspects of the show to be executed properly. I personally am wary of automatically assuming that the people directly responsible for doing certain jobs were not qualified to do so well, because I've interviewed a VFX artist here on my channel, and she said that when VFX turn out bad, the artists more or less always know that it looks bad, and it just means that the people higher up the corporate hierarchy were not giving them enough money and or hours to complete the job in such a way that the quality of work would be high. I don't know what happened with this show, but there were just so many problems in the technical look of the filmmaking. Another example of this is when Theo has been stabbed and he's bleeding out in the bathroom. They do this sort of blacking out, fading in and out effect where essentially it's supposed to be, I presume, like a POV shot of Theo slipping in and out of consciousness because he's been badly wounded, so the footage of Apollo is what's fading in and out. But the problem is that the camera is not set up in such a way where Apollo is looking directly into the camera as if he was looking at Theo. The camera is set up in such a way that it looks like we are just an objective outside observer of what's happening in the scene. So it makes zero sense for the footage to be fading in and out like that. A recurring issue the show has, in a very broad sense, is not living up to its potential. For example, when the show first starts and they keep talking about Oliver and how big and bad whatever happened with Oliver was, I was really hooked and intrigued to this buildup of who Oliver was as a character and what exactly happened with him and the rest of the Fairmont family in the past. There was some sort of falling out. But when they finally revealed him on the show, he just kind of came across like a whiny, bratty older brother and more like a brooding teenager, to be quite honest. It just didn't meet my expectations. I was disappointed, and I didn't hate or dislike the character. I just ultimately felt let down. The pacing felt off for a fair bit of the season as well. For example, in the very first episode, it was jarring to go from just barely being introduced to Juliet and Cal, and all of a sudden they're making out in a closet. I personally would have preferred for them to make me wait just a little bit longer and do the build-up, you know, let me feel that yearning that they have for each other before they deliver the payoff. I kind of got that they were trying to quickly get to this very dramatic incident of the kissing and the staking in the closet so they could instead go back and reveal Cal's POV of what led up to that moment. But if anything, I feel like that would have made for an even more interesting and tension-filled viewing experience if you had shown both of their perspectives in that lead-up, so you're left wondering, are we going to have them kiss? And ultimately, Cal's desire to prove herself as a hunter will win? Or will her romantic and physical attraction to Juliet be what triumphs? Another problem that comes from having the characters get together so quickly is that in the overall pacing, the only place you have left to go is conflict and demise, which is how the season ends for them. Admittedly, I'm happy for the viewers that they don't have to experience yet another incident of the bury your gaze trope, but it's disappointing that the ending isn't them together, when we really don't have that guarantee that the show will be renewed to continue the story and find their way back to each other. A lot of the people tuning in, I'm guessing, are wanting to see it work out for Juliet and Cal in the end. And that's how I felt watching the show. I wanted to see them reaffirm their love for each other and for us as an audience to see them committed to being together and not allowing these centuries-old conflicts stand in the way of their love. Just because Romeo and Juliet ended tragically doesn't mean that people are tuning in to First Kill wanting to see it all fall apart for them in the end, which is what happened. The show was at its best when it was leaning into the whole concept of being supernatural, serving as an allegory for the struggle of being part of a socio-politically ostracized identity group. Those protests and the mob of that hate group, it really conjures comparisons to the people who protested against the integration of schools in America or anti-LGBT plus protesters, things of that nature. But what's nice about using the supernatural concept in the way First Kill does is that the young viewers who are tuning in don't have to see people hating this couple because they're an interracial couple or because they're a sapphic couple. So it allows for this barrier emotionally and psychologically, so those viewers don't have to feel like they're being directly attacked the way they might if those protesters were attacking one of those other identity groups instead of the supernatural identity group. Another thing I want to give favorable feedback to, besides Juliet and Cal being really cute together, is that I enjoyed a lot of the women characters and performances on this show. Of course, Elizabeth Mitchell is a familiar face to many television viewers, so you can expect that she's gonna get the job done. But I also wanted to give credit to Aubin Wise as Talia. I really connected to her performance, particularly in those moments where she's really letting that maternal energy shine. I loved that moment where she's putting her foot down to her husband and refusing to let him kill Theo after he is turned into a vampire. She fully embraces him as her son, regardless of the fact that he is her stepson. That was a beautiful character moment. I also thought Gracie Dzienny was excellent as Eleanor. I just loved her unapologetically feminine villain energy. It's all the character details, like her immaculate clothes, hair, her extensive collection of lipsticks. You know, we really don't have a lot of female serial killers in fiction, and I just thought it made for a very enjoyable watch. I would be intrigued to see her, if there is a season two, going on the war path against her parents. That confrontation between her and Theo in the interrogation room at the end of the season was such a powerful character moment, because up until that point, I didn't know if they were going to try to have her do some sort of turnaround and maybe go towards a path of finding redemption and reconciling with her brother. But she reiterated that she does not feel bad for anything she's done, and she's seemingly going to continue being a baddie. And I'm intrigued by the potential that has to offer power in the storytelling. I struggle to imagine that the show would be renewed, but if it is, it needs to either have an increased budget or a better allocated budget in regards to the various expenses for the general production and filmmaking process. Even the part where Sebastian goes all reptilian feral and kills Davina and eats her, that entire sequence of just how it was filmed and edited, it was just some very odd choices and it looked cheap, which makes me suspicious that the show simply wasn't given enough money or the money was not allocated properly, because things like that where it looks cheap, it just takes away from all of the good things that we, the audience, should be paying attention to with the story and the characters. I can't help but feel like in so many ways this show has been set up to fail, and that feels especially cruel when you have a young queer audience yearning to have their own epic supernatural romance saga. If it does get renewed, I hope it finds its footing in season 2, because queer viewers should absolutely be included in the fun of soapy supernatural romance dramas. There are decent aspects of the show to work with, and with the right leadership and budgeting, there's no reason the show shouldn't have success. 13 Reasons Why was an awful show, but people kept watching it and Netflix kept renewing it. I don't think First Kill is awful at all. I think it is flawed and has potential that I would love to see fulfilled. So, if you've seen First Kill, let me know what your thoughts were of it. Feel free to stick around and check out some more of my reviews on films and television series, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!